Hello, welcome back to retention reporting. So we're talking about dispersed retention that can have large amounts of complexity, variability, and overwhelming structure. So here's an example on the photograph on the screen of a block you may just encounter. You're out there, and now how do we survey this? How do we ultimately measure accomplishments, and how do we report that into results? You get various aspects within, we get this circle of retention trees in the backdrop. How do we report that section of the block? How do we deal with this retained overstory layer one tree in the foreground with the arrow on it? How does that get reported? Does it contribute to stocking? Does it not? How do we deal with the regen that's in the foreground? Is it tall enough? Is it the right species? Does it meet the objectives? Is it underneath the canopy of other trees within the block? These are all questions that add to levels of complexity. And so during this presentation, we're going to hope to look at simplifying complexity. We look at this definition by Constantine. Simplicity is complexity resolved. So this is where we're going to try and go is work on the simplicity side of complexity, and that's going to be the objective for today, is to try to get there. So let's start with a brief history of retention in British Columbia. This is Dave's version. This is my version. Sort of throughout my career and my interpretation of how retention's kind of gone throughout the province. So we started in the 1980s, basically clear-cut regime in most of the province. There's certain sectors within the interior that were doing some form of partial cutting at that point in time, but not a lot of retention. A straightforward kind of process. And then the classic silviculture systems are introduced more readily around the province, test modes within the small business program, introducing a lot of different approaches using classic silviculture systems from Europe, used in the United States, and what we all learned in school in silviculture systems. And were tried, but not operationally done, but a lot more stems on the landscape. How did we deal with those things? Then in the late 90s, early 2000s, variable retention came in, sort of a result of pressure in Clackwood Sound on the West Coast, and various levels of retention were being introduced. McMillan-Bodell and then Weyerhaeuser did quite a bit of research on how the impact of various retention, these stems underneath, retained stems in the overstory, end up having an impact on growth and implications for growth and yield. And then finally, we're kind of where we are today. These hybrid systems, we're getting blends of what systems are being deployed, mixes of various types of approaches that are moving away from the classic silviculture systems and blending things together, even dropping words and coming up with new terms and new hybrids of systems. So a bit of a transition. Where do we land? We're not in classic book. We're definitely past clear cuts. We're in a bit of a mixed state. So I'm going to make a bit of an attempt to define things a little bit here and work with complex structure and try to categorize it. So I'm going to follow the model that we published in the surveys manual in 2010. And we sort of broke it down into these three groupings of basically even-aged structure, which is identified by this two-dimensional diagram, where I'm going to try to use throughout the day, throughout this presentation, to show how things are structure is identified, how it's represented. But in this presentation, we're going to deal with the next two. We're going to deal with complex vertical structure and complex horizontal. Now, again, you can get a blend of both, but it's an attempt to separate and hopefully give you some boundaries, some parameters in order to define stance. Again, it's all of these concepts or these presentation ideas stem from the survey's manual and the attempts put together by myself leading folks around the province and generating within the survey's manual and trying to encapsulate complex structure and try to deal with it in a functional way. So first, complex vertical structure, as you see I've highlighted the V up above. So it's structure that's moving up through the layers within the stand, within the canopy, right from the lower layers up to the mature layers. And so examples of this may be multi-story uneven aged management. And we can have even aged management, which may not have as much structure as above here, not much as much diversity or occupancy within the various layers within the canopies, but still having some diversity, still having variable, still having a lot of vertical structure. So the third type again would be horizontal structure, where we're dealing with the big H, we're going this way, so across the block, so this way, walking through the block, we're getting a variety of different structures. So usually only one or two layers of trees, canopy layers of trees, if we want to describe it that at this stage. So again, we have the example up top here of intermediate cut or commercial thinning, where you're really taking out the mature content and leaving some sort of groupings or even spacing here in a commercial thinning type of example of mature stems within the block. Clear cuts with reserves, again, the same situation, but we just have homogeneous units or groupings of trees within certain layer classes grouped throughout the block, but they're large enough that you can actually have them as aggregates. So we get this diversity of structure this way. And again, obviously we can have hybrids of both, and that's when it gets really complex. So first let's start talking about the tree retention guidebook. Hopefully you can't hear me turning my page too much and I'm not disturbing the recording so much. So we're going to deal with the tree retention guidebook. So I'll just give you an idea of what we're going to go through. As the latest version was produced just under a year ago, March 2014, and the previous version was in 2009. It's really what we're going to go over is the basically within the table of contents, we have the scope and introduction to the whole application. There's a list of terms used. Definitions and explanations, and then I'm going to go over the matrix that I talked about earlier. And yes, we have the dude from the matrix. I can't remember his name now. Lee? I want to say Lee for some reason, but can't remember. That's too bad. But the guy with the sunglasses. Yes, we will venture into the matrix later on, this blend, and stay tuned. We'll see what that looks like. So let's just look at what the scope and introduction to this whole tree retention reporting manual is. And you can find, let's go back there a minute, you can find this publication on the results website, and you go into document. Once you pull up the results website, it's in documents, and on the left-hand side, there'll be a button there, and once that opens up, you can go into and find it entitled by that name right here. Okay, so the scope and introduction, it really adds this document, this tree retention reporting document, it adds to the results information submissions specifications documents. These are the ones that are actually encrypted in law. These are the form and manner that the Chief Forester has approved for licensees to report into results. And there's one of these documents for major licensees, for government, and for woodlots. So this is an addition to that, additional guidance, I guess would be the best way to frame it, to those legal documents. Within this treated retention guidebook, there's examples for silviculture and harvesting practices resulting in planned or unplanned treated retention, which is greater than 5 square meters per hectare of basal area. So that's the threshold that you have to worry about reporting. If you have less than 5 square meters, then we blend it into the regular reporting on the documents above. So this document really gives you that guidance for those thresholds. Silviculture systems, you know, the nomenclature has changed, as I mentioned earlier, sort of that transition of NBC and these hybrid systems, the names have come up, but results has not. So in reality, what the treed retention guidebook does is try to fit with what resulting structure and silviculture system name you might be using. It's a best fit into those three categories that we have permanently established within results in order to get the reporting done. And you know, the whole intent here is to help users with existing results design, and the end result is hopefully have some reporting consistency. Now, it's a bit of a complicated document. Some people find it rather clunky, I guess would be the term. It doesn't really flow. This is what this training is about, is to assist in some understanding and some context and the thinking behind that and trying to achieve that consistency province-wide. So treated retention reporting, it's a requirement. We just want to highlight here for sure and to be very clear about it, that openings that have this greater than 5 square meters of basal area per hectare, the overstory must be reported in the inventory. So if you've got it, you have to report a layer 1 inventory label. It's mandatory. It's actually legal requirement. So the chief forester needs that tree forest cover data in order to make appropriate timber supply review and actually reflect the practice on the ground. It's the only thing that we can do. So when you've got with this photo here, if you've got that in the overstory, you've got to report it in results. You can't just roll in one layer, your regen layer, into results and have that reported. We need that secondary layer, inventory label, at this stage of the game. As well, you know, if you do have layer 4, the understory layer, I should say, we haven't really gone through those definitions yet for folks that are not familiar with it, but it's the overstory layer plus what other layers you do have there that we require for reporting. So, I always get asked, my goodness, Dave, you know, basal area is such a tough thing to measure, even visually to estimate. Why don't you go with stems per hectare? Well, that's a reasonable question, but it's basal area that really has the impact on growing on the understory, because what I'm told is, and it makes sense with all the modelers, the bigger the more basal area, the bigger the crown width and all of those things. It's easier to model in those contexts, and it makes sense when we get into retention and the impact on growth in the understory, especially when we talk about deviation from potential. So basically, what 5 square meters is, if you're using a prism with BAF number 5, one tree in your sweep is 5 square meters. So here's the here's a plot, and watch the magic hand come up. There we go. And it has a prism, a refractive prism that reflects the light, and it reflects so much light, moves the image over, depending on what basal area factor you use, or BAF. And you can see in this diagram that the side of the tree is refracted over and still overlaps. So that means that tree is within your basal area sweep. So if you're out in the field and you do your sweep, there you go. That is 5 square meters. This individual back here would not be refracted if I moved it over. And so actually what you're looking at right here is 5 square meters. So with basal area retention, there's three types of stand conditions that I see in my travels around the province, and this is a key factor, is the diameter of the residual stems, and it varies geographically around the province. And so, you know, 5 square meters in one neck of the woods in BC can be different than 5 square meters on the west coast of Vancouver Island. So as you can see, in I've tried to separate it into three different types. So we have coastal old growth that's still remaining on the west coast and north, certain parts of Queen Charlotte's, and basically everything green there on this biogeoclimatic map of British Columbia. Second growth coastal, which is becoming very common to log right now, and interior, a bit of a, you know, we can get a little bit of both of coastal old growth and coastal second growth in the interior in some of the larger mature zones in the ICH, and maybe to an extent in some of the older old growth sections in the ESSF in the interior. So, you know, maybe this is a bit of a snapshot or an oversimplification, but just to give you a bit of a context, just orients what I'm going to show you now in some example maps. So, map example photos. So, what the heck does 5 square meters look like? We're just going to roll through that right now. And here's a coastal old growth stand, which is greater than 5 square meters, especially with this large cedar left over in the foreground. And actually, throughout this whole block, we've surveyed it several times. We come up with an annual average of 20 square meters. So again, bit of a tough one. You have to realize that that 5 square meter threshold is not a plot basis. It's on a whole block basis. So again, same block further down the road, different cedar tree, but again, you get an idea of what you're seeing behind here. I'm just gonna flip through these photos. So here's another one on the north end of the island. That other shot was in Tofino. This is on the north end of Vancouver Island, and again, greater than 5 square meters. This is more corridor logging, where these strips were taken out with high lead, and some trees were pulled out of the reserve bits. So you can see it's quite a bit higher in here, much higher than 14 square meters, but considering this open patch in between, overall, it's 14 square meters. Again, a real difficulty visually to say, yeah, right off the bat, what the basal area is. I wouldn't be able to do that and without putting in some random plots. Here's coastal second growth. This is a stems trial by north of Campbell River. This is just over 5 square meters. It's actually been measured a dozen times, and it may not be totally captured in this photograph, but this is actually 6 square meters, just over 5. So obviously in here, much lower capacity. This is probably over 6, but overall, this is around 6 square meters, fairly light, right on the edge. I would have thought it would have been less than 5, but the data shows it's around 6 square meters. So, okay, hopefully we're building a little bit of memory here as to what 5 square meters looks like. Here we are again in the Chilliwack Valley. This is less than 5 square meters, coastal second growth as well. You can see a lot of these open areas here and here. Some groupings here, you know, if you put your plot in here, that would be higher than 5 square meters. But again, overall, collectively, we're less than 5 square meters. So here's interior. We're into sort of the third type, and we've got less than 5 square meters within this plot. And you can see this individual would be in if I had a BAF 5, and probably. And we've got some openings, got some groupings over here, but again, a little more open in behind. No need to report the overstory in this situation. Just right in this plot within the photo, we're actually less than 5 square meters, but within the whole block, actually it ended up being around 12 square meters. So once I pulled back a little bit, it's starting to get up there. We start including some of these individuals in this patch over here. This is in Terrace, actually, and these are, I believe, are pine in the overstory. This is greater than 5 square meters. It's actually 16 square meters because we've got quite a few retained over here. We've got a little bit of an opening here, but these guys are in quite a row, fairly tight together. You start to get a bit of a feel for what it looks like. And if you look straight up, right before I took that photo, this is what I see above me. And again, so it gives you a visual idea of greater than 5 square meters. I mean, fairly thin crowns. Of course, if these were Douglas fir, they would be much bigger crowns, where these are pine. But it gives you an idea of the stem distribution, a visual idea anyway. That's my attempt here, is just to assist, with that aspect of visually trying to get that visual image going on 5 square meters. So here we're on the interior. This is a larch stand, and in the, where are we here? Cranbrook, and again, greater than 5 square meters, a lot of larch and some Douglas fir left in the overstory. I think the pine was mostly removed, and we've got 15 square meters. So the, you know, this patch down in here probably elevated that number quite a bit. We've got some groupings here as well. So, you know, that 5 square meter line, fairly limited impact in the growing space of the understory. That's the key. And so once we get over that 5 square meter threshold, that's when we need to report that layer ones. So there we go. Here's our terms to be defined. Forest cover canopy layers, and it's, I'm going to be going through about 5 different terms that are listed in the retention guidebook and the tree retention booklet, and it's fundamental that the first one that we go through, first term, is forest cover canopy layers. And as you can see, hopefully my moving mouse with my little arrow is not driving everyone crazy, but we've got 4 layers: mature, layer 1, pole, layer 2, sapling, layer 3, and regeneration, layer 4. And you can see the qualifications of these layers. Basically, this is a mature layer, greater than or equal to 12.5 dBH. The pole, smaller, 7.5 to 12.49 centimeter dBH. Then we have the sapling, layer 3, greater than breast height, 1.3, but less than 7.5. And then we've got the regen layer, our regeneration layer, layer 4, less than and equal to 1.3 meters in height. So I refer to all these layers all the time, trying again to capsulize the complex structure that we would be inheriting in a block and then put it in those layers. Wonderfully, this results accepts these layers. If you can describe your stands in these layers, it makes life a little bit easier. I know there's other ways of describing structure, and they may be even more suitable. But ultimately, when it has to get into results, this is what it accepts as these definitions of layers. Next term I want to define is residuals and retention, and these are fundamental principles within the tree retention guidebook and will really assist when you get into the matrix, the reporting. So residuals and retention, these are basically layer 1 trees that are retained. Now they can be singularly or in groups after an area, bounded area, has been subject to stand disturbance. There's the hardcore definition of residuals and retention. And obviously stand disturbance is harvesting or natural events that happen within a bounded area. So that's the second term we want to kind of define. Our third one is reserve type. Turn the pages here, get a quick little drink of water. Drink of tea in this case. So, reserve type. We have 2 different types of reserves: group or dispersed. And these are really fundamental aspects to remember when we're classifying some or categorizing complex structures. So grouped retention. They're unharvested residual trees, treed patches of aggregated individuals that are mappable. That's a key here. So a group is mappable, usually greater than 0.25 of a hectare in size. So a quarter of a hectare in size, like these little patches down here that are mappable and grouped together. The second reserve type is dispersed, residual treed portions with usually individually separated stems and are not mappable. You cannot map them, they just don't work out. As in this example, you would go crazy trying to map out all of these retained sections in this helicopter log block. And they're usually, if there's any kind of aggregate like these little groupings of individuals down in the lower left-hand corner, those are really difficult to map out as well. So the intent is not to map those. Okay, so the fourth term we're going to go into is the length of term. And this is really a function of the objective of whatever you're retaining these stems for. And again, it's a fundamental fork in the road in results to look at long-term residuals, or what we another attach the word reserves to, or short-term residuals or retention. So those are some terms that will help you in understanding the terminology in the tree retention guidebook. So long-term residuals or reserves are not available for subsequent harvest entry until after the next rotation planting cycle. So referred to as reserves are usually some sort of non-timber reason that they're there, wildlife tree patch, all kinds of culturally heritage reasons, some reason like that. So they're retained for that until after the next cycle. Short-term residuals, basically retention available for subsequent harvest entry prior to the end of the current planting cycle, whether or not they're harvested. So they can be retained possibly to come back for a midterm removal if it's economically feasible, but they usually referred to retention. And so the silviculture objective, if it's your objective for that block is timber, and they're available for subsequent harvest, but not necessarily they don't have to be, then your regeneration objective would have to embrace that those stems would be still present and be addressed within the silviculture standard. So I'll explain that a little bit more later, and maybe it will come a bit clearer if you stick around for the module 2. So ultimately, they could look the same. You could end up with the same structure on the ground, but a different objective. These individuals have been retained for the whole rotation for, say, their CMTs or something like that. So these are long-term reserves, where these are really, maybe this is a some form of multi-entry cut or deviation from potential and potentially come back and take out these Douglas fir that were left over in the block subsequent to operational constraints or whatever. So they may look exactly the same, but there's a different reason that they're there and would be identified as short-term within results. Okay, so the last term I think there's six terms, is there? Yes, there is. There's six. I think I only mentioned five in the front there, so there is six. I'll have to make that edit. So the fifth one here is reserve objective. And I've kind of touched on that already. Once you define the type of reserve, the length of the reserve, you identify the reserve objective. So if the trees are going to be left, the retention is going to be left. If it's non-timber, there's several options within results. Folks who are familiar with the acronyms, and you know, there's several types of reasons why you're going to leave these reserves, either individuals or grouped, for cultural heritage reasons, visual, wildlife tree reserve, these are normally the longer term types of reserves. Timber objective normally can be a shorter term, but usually a longer term objective is involved. The shorter term would be for really the multiple entry, multi-story type of approach. And so the last term is tree cover pattern. And this is a requirement to report that into results, and it's primarily an inventory-driven parameter. It's usually a value from 1 to 9, so it's just a number. And so this is a tree cover pattern, is the horizontal spatial arrangement of residual patches of the overstory in the polygon. And as I said, it comes right from the VRI, Vegetation Resource Inventory Photo Interpretation Procedures, page 60 to 61. You want to go to that manual, go to the Forest Analysis and Inventory Branches website, and you can find that manual. These guys were really keen on us, if we have covered retention, to record this tree cover pattern. Somewhat subjective, I got to admit, from 1 to 9, and they sort of overlap a little bit. Again, the tree retention guidebook makes a really good attempt to catalog the describe sort of the attributes that would be within those patterns. So here's a couple of examples. You can see number 1 and number 2, single to very few occurrences, limited extent, circular, irregular shape, single to very few occurrences, limited extent, linear, elongated shapes. So, and it progresses, like the shaded sections are what's left over. And so we'll go all the way up to 9, where it's just these little, small little openings, not very low impact on the block. So the retention is fairly extensive. So again, it's an attempt to categorize that pattern. This is something that can be tallied in the field, or you obviously in technology nowadays, if you've got some good resolution satellite images or photos, high resolution photos, you can do that really quickly. So not a busy procedure. Okay,